Welcome to the first episode of the Monocle Banking Podcast for 2024. I certainly hope it's a fruitful year for you. It feels like we've hit the ground running and this old V8 engine is trying to turn into an EV as I get myself ready for what is hopefully a year of change and positive change in South Africa and indeed around the world. I'm your host, Michael Avery, and today we've got a special edition tucking into a groundbreaking initiative that is reshaping South Africa's energy landscape and also our nationally determined commitments to decarbonize the South African economy. And we've made some pretty audacious, hairy goals, our lodestars in that regard. We're at a very early and evolving stage of what is called the just energy transition, the JET, and there are no doubt complex challenges to overcome. Project preparation isn't where it needs to be. A few of the concessional loan pledges that were made to the JETIP have become financing agreements. So new climate funds are not yet flowing at scale into targeted projects. And there's obviously much that needs to be done to build institutional capability for efficient and cost-effective execution. And all of this happens while there has been some muttering around the decommissioning of Komati Power Station in Mpumalanga back in 2022. And I'm really looking forward to tucking into this. This is probably going to be the first of a series of podcasts that we do on this topic because it is just simply so vast. Well, I'm really thrilled to be joined to kick us off by one of the lead authors of the JET implementation plan. It's a visionary document paving the way for South Africa's journey towards a low carbon and climate resilient economy. And there was another very interesting report published in December in draft form about scaling finance to support a just transition, because this is an opportunity, but it is going to require vast sums of capital to be invested in order to see these goals come to fruition. Dipak Patel from the Presidential Climate Commission of South Africa, he joined the PCC in June 2021 as head of climate finance and innovation, and he really leads the team in its work in the areas of climate finance mapping, financing a just transition, and developing a strategy for financing the pathway to a net zero emissions target for 2050. And just a bit more background, the PCC was established and is co-chaired by South Africa's President Cyril Ramaphosa. But Dipak, I'll let you tell us a little bit more about the work of the PCC as well. As a chemical engineer and a qualified artisanal brewer as well, you've certainly got vast interests. You've got an MSc in Development Economics from the University of London. I hope you do, given the scandal currently around qualifications, and an MBA from the University of Wits. Thanks so much for joining us on the show. How are you doing?
Very, very well. Thank you, Michael. It's been, as you say, a rapid start to the new year. And let me use this opportunity to wish you and your family well during the course of 2024 as well. And to the listeners, I hope that 2024 is going to see the resolution of many of the crises that we are seeing both in South Africa, on the continent, and of course, as we're fully aware, around the world. Let me straight off say that I was not singularly the author of the Just Energy Transition Investment Plan. Just by way of quick background, so that I'm not accused of falsely laying claim.
Oh, sure. I did say one of. Yes.
We can cover the genesis of the JET all the way back to Glasgow at COP26, and we can talk about as well what the foundational elements of the just energy transition, as well as the JETP, which is the Just Energy Transition Partnership, which includes at that time five entities, including developed countries, but also a particularly large MDB. And then more laterally, as the plan took shape, joined by others. So, Michael, with those words, let me also say that you've sketched a broad swathe of the critical challenges, which cut to the heart, I think, not only of our global responsibility, which we've adopted, by the way, through a submission of our nationally determined contributions in 2021, setting the stage for ambition as it relates to decarbonization, but then quickly supporting that with at least a political economic view of how to achieve that. And then finally, you've sketched some of the challenges as well in the context of energy scarcity, energy insecurity accompanied by load shedding? What is the rate at which South Africa can afford to close down its existing coal-fired power stations? A large number of challenges, but in all of this, through those challenges and through the risks that we face, I think what the JET does is makes an early foundational statement of what South Africa can do to achieve a platform from which to take advantage of our position, our capabilities, as well as make good our global contribution to decarbonization. A very complex undertaking indeed that will require everyone, not just the state, to get its act together and prepare to successfully implement it.
Dipak, thanks for that. And maybe for the listeners, it's good to establish a base as to who is driving the process of the just energy transition, because we've got the Presidential Climate Commission, we've got various government departments, we've got the NBI, the National Business Initiative, and I know Joanne Yar, which has now moved across to work more closely with the PCC. So how does that architecture come together, and where do the roles and responsibilities ultimately reside?
Michael, in the initial period, I think we adopted a situational approach to the challenge at hand. As we know, different mandates sit in different parts of government, not only different at the level of national government, but also challenging and different in terms of capability and scope to implement space for financial capability. The Presidential Climate Commission's genesis, interestingly, was in 2018 at the Presidential Job Summit. And it was at that point, again, something not very well known, that labor, organized labor in South Africa, seeing that the climate transition and climate response was inevitable, whatever the pace was at which we unfolded it, and therefore raised the issue of a social partner mechanism to ensure that as we undertake the transition, we in essence left no one behind. And so it was out of that that the Presidential Climate Commission was created. So the Presidential Climate Commission, chaired by the president, deputy chair is Vali Musa, who in the first term of democratic government was Minister of Environmental Affairs. Quite interestingly enough, commissioners then drawn not on the basis of elections or anything, but on the basis that they came from many sectors and included, amongst others, civil society, business, labor through its organized formations, young people, as well as academics and scientists who were involved in climate issues. That secretariat that was formed on the back of the commissions being appointed was then led by Crispian Olver, who also, interestingly enough, was the Democratic era's first Director General for Environmental Affairs. And so what we see is a coming together of all facets that would be absolutely crucial to work in harmony and to the extent possible with consensus towards what a transition would look like. Very early on, the Presidential Climate Commission harnessed all of the modeling that had been done in various institutions and by the business sector into advising government with respect to what a realistic but nonetheless ambitious nationally determined contributions would be. And so in 2021, we saw the PCC recommending to government what its submission to the United Nations Framework Convention for Climate Change, the UNFCCC, would be. And it's on the back of that that we believe, leading up to COP26 in 2021, where we all know that the developed world had failed to live up to its promised $100 billion per year as its contribution to decarbonization in developing countries, led, I believe, to the partnership that was forged in the form of the Just Energy Transition Partnership. Once that partnership was formed, supported by a political declaration which enunciated three sectors that would see a deep decarbonization to 2030, we then had to do the hard work of negotiating the financial package, at that time $8.5 billion. And then on the basis of that promise, I think we, South Africa, took a bold step and said, listen, 8.5 billion, we know intuitively, is not going to take us very far. Let's develop a just energy transition investment plan. And it was that hard work led by the JET Peace Secretariat, ably led at that time by Joanne Jawicz, and reporting into the International Partners Group on the one hand, and the Presidential Climate Finance Task Team, which was led at that time by Daniel Minella. I served on it. We then developed the JET investment plan, which was adopted by Cabinet. And it is that JET investment plan that quantified to the year 2030 a need for the deep and fundamental transformation of our electricity sector towards renewables and greener energy sources. But it also saw the opportunities that arose in green hydrogen. And finally, we saw the writing on the wall with respect to the developed world phasing out internal combustion engine vehicles and understanding what an important role the auto manufacturing and assembly sector in South Africa plays right now, after many years of being assisted either through the fiscus or through incentives for its development to this current stage. We saw what the risks were for the auto sector, and therefore of imperative importance was the introduction of some conversation, at least, to what would South Africa's role be in a continued competitiveness in the global motor sector if we are to transform the current manufacturing and assembly capabilities towards new energy, or more particularly, electric vehicles. So that was the foundational thinking that then laid the basis for what are the three critical sectors to 2030, at least, that we need to pay attention to as we decarbonize our energy system and ensure that we take advantage of some of our current competitiveness, as well as look to the future with respect to nascent opportunities that we foresee arising, not only for domestic consumption production, but also for domestic production that could lend itself to an export industry.
And on that note, the narrowing down of the focus, I think, is something that is to be welcomed, because often with these things, they can come across as more of an aspirational wish list than a pragmatic roadmap if one is too broad and too all-encompassing. And I think the way first situationally the plan was conceptualized, but then institutionalized, and now with the focus being narrowed down, we are getting to a point where we have something that is far more tangible. You've got a very ambitious funding target of around 1.5 trillion rand, I believe, over 5 years. So talk to me about those three sectors and where you see, firstly, the big opportunities, and then secondly, the challenges that have to be overcome in order to unlock those.
Sure. And you make an important observation at a more general level, Michael, and that is, you know, ambition always carries the risk of either inability to implement wholly, or we hope the risk that some parts of it may be difficult or not possible to implement. In the way in which we conceptualize this for the three sectors, I think there is room for different degrees of success, and which different degrees of success do not result then in such a statement of ambition having been presented that we throw the baby out with the bathwater. So in each one of those sectors, there are some critical milestones or a critical path made up of milestones that need to be achieved. But in partnership, and given South Africa's mixed economy nature, as well as the state of development of both our industry in terms of manufacturing, engineering, as well as technology capability on the one hand, and secondly, the depth and scale of our domestic capital and financial markets, even in the context of the fiscal constraints that we face, lead us, at least who are optimists and I would say pragmatists, to believe that these three pathways, if we were to rapidly unfold them, implement them to the best of our ability in partnership with all those who have the capabilities to do their bit, then I believe that by 2030 we could have laid a solid platform where, rather than being takers of global regulation or global risk elements that start to present themselves in the form of carbon border adjustment mechanisms, that we would have at least have laid a basis to be able to successfully compete and fend off some of the dire risks that present themselves. So if you would like, I'd be happy to go through each one of those three, the energy sector, new energy vehicles, and green hydrogen very briefly.
Please.
To discuss. Okay, so if we start with electricity, which literally is 85 to 87% of the jet IP, here what we are seeing is firstly that almost 90% of our current electricity is produced by Eskom's power station fleet, which in turn is largely coal-fired, except for Kuberg, which is two units of nuclear energy. What we are also seeing is that Eskom has not invested, except for Medupi and Kusile, which themselves have their issues, which we can unpack perhaps in a later podcast, because they are material. We are seeing that the average age of Eskom's power station fleet is approaching 40 years.
Yeah.
And what this means with the lifespan, expected economic lifespan of 50 years per power station, is a critical decisioning point around whether we simply let power stations come to the end of their natural economic life and then gracefully shut them down, or as some posit, and that again in a future podcast we can unpack, there is a split view even within government with respect to this question of extending the life of coal-fired power stations. But we sit in a, in my opinion anyway, a relatively sweet spot where if we were to be able to harness degrees of grant, concessional, donor financing to shut down power stations as they approach end of life, maybe a few years earlier, then what we have is the financial feasibility of shutting them down gracefully, but in the process, also the challenge of having to bring into the mix renewable energy and greener energy sourced electricity into that mix. And here again, you will know that the IRP recently released for public comment do make some statements about a continuation of coal, do make some statements about a pace of renewable energy that not everybody might agree with. And the PCC certainly is going to weigh in as constructively as we can with our alternative views, where we do have alternative views. Having said that, there are some what I would call no regret moves that should be compatible with all potential energy mix scenarios. And those relate to, firstly, the state of our national grid, both in terms of a need to extend it, as well as a need to strengthen it. Secondly, creating the conditions for a rapid increase, acceleration of renewable energy projects funded in large part now that we've de-risked through the REIPP program by the private sector. And thirdly, it raises the issue of how within our existing operating power fleet, we begin to get our energy availability factors up, which rely on firstly, effective and efficient production management of energy for the operating power stations. And as we all know, the challenge of trying to eke back or claw back on the lost years of poor maintenance. If we get a harmony between all of these elements, and in the course of doing that, start also pulling back load shedding from higher stages to lower stages and hopefully eventually ending it over the next couple of years, we believe that we can mobilize both the financial resources that are necessary, but also in the process of clear signaling, send the right messages to both the private and the public sector with respect to project preparation, with respect to risk measurement, and with respect to both domestic and international investors finding attractive locations for their decisions with respect to investment. And so in the electricity sector, we see firstly finding the means by which the grid can be extended and strengthened, and that has both financial as well as planning investment, as well as project and logistics challenges. Secondly, renewable energy. We believe that we need to up the ante and really accelerate the pace at which private sector-led renewable energy projects come on the ground. Within that, there are a set of complexities which we could unpack. And then finally, as I said, to begin to get greater levels of efficiency and operational management competence into operating our existing fleet. So that's electricity.
So on that point, on the grid issue, I think it's an important point you make, that despite the contestation around the various pathways and energy mixes, I think everyone can agree that the grid needs to be expanded in certain areas, and particularly around provinces that have huge potential for adding additional renewable resources in solar and wind. I see this playing out because it almost feels a bit chicken and egg. Does it happen in parallel that you start bidding for particular renewable projects alongside building out and expanding grid capacity in the Northern Cape, for example? How do you envision this taking place?
So that's a very interesting issue that requires, firstly, coherent modeling. Secondly, as much as there might be a theoretical approach that says we need to progress linearly, I believe that we need to progress in parallel and creatively. And in respect of the grid, the creation of the South African grid company, I think it's called the National South African Transmission Company, is the first step, which both the JET IP, as well as the PCC, as well as government, I think, have agreed is a necessary step. And within this is a set of questions that get raised that require, for want of a better word, social consensus. There is a fear on the part of unions, organized labor, that the creation of the grid company, as well as an argument that says we need to find private sector participation models for the grid expansion and grid upgrade, amounts to privatization. I do not believe that. We have experience of quite creative financing arrangements and project arrangements in South Africa, whether we're talking about the toll roads, whether we're talking about some of our build, operate, transfer approaches to infrastructure in South Africa. Those all can remain under the ownership of the grid company, but conditions created where you, I was going to say entice, but really encourage and attract the private sector to come in various ways. And so I think a current debate that will unfold in the early part of this year is, given that there's a consensus across the board that the grid needs to be strengthened and expanded, what are the creative modalities through which, in the absence of fiscal resources, in the absence of Eskom's balance sheet itself being able to support this, how does a solvent, reasonably healthy balance sheet of the South African Transmission Company support the leveraging of private sector capital into these projects? But more importantly, I think the private sector has also displayed, whether we're talking about through renewable energy projects or whether we're talking about the actual engineering and implementation function, which is outsourced and subcontracted by Eskom as we speak now, how do we encourage that sector to prepare for its own transformation, to come into its own, to not just be engineering service providers, but in fact, fully fledged operators, as well as maintenance, and potentially for 15, 20 years, have the wherewithal to put in place really complex, but nonetheless doable, concession type of arrangements where you pass on the risk for an appropriate type of reward and let those parts of South African society and economy do what they are best geared to do. So I think by about mid-year, we'll have some degree of understanding and consensus about, at least for the grid, where the private sector could possibly come in. Other creative approaches include what we call load balancing, and that is encourage the private sector to overbuild renewables deliberately at the very beginning while the grid gets strengthened to catch up over a period of time. So, you know, the mismatch in time to implement is that a renewable energy in the form of a solar PV plant and a solar PV field is between 2 years and 2.5 years, whereas a grid program on average would be between 5 and 7 years. How do you put in place the guarantee mechanisms, the assurances that are required for overbuild of renewable, which might be a little inefficient because we're not utilizing it completely for the first 2 or 3 years, but once the grid catches up, you can ramp up production and in fact bring it to bear. So there are those creative approaches which, while they might cost a little more initially, really set the stage for a ramping up in the outer years in this 2023 to 2030 set of scenarios.
Very interesting, Dipak. And just before we move on to the other two sectors, new energy vehicles and green hydrogen, one more question. It does seem to be one of the more burning questions around some of the socioeconomic, maybe more political challenges in bringing those affected communities along and persuading them that these things, while difficult, change is always difficult and uncomfortable, are necessary. And that's why it's so encouraging to hear that Labour is playing such an important role here. It was most recently revealed around the Komati decommissioning that the community in the surrounding area perhaps weren't consulted as comprehensively as would have been hoped for. And so there does seem to be some discontent. How does the PCC plan to address the deep-seated concerns within Mpumalanga communities regarding job losses resulting from coal-fired power plant and coal mine closures, especially in light of some skepticism that's been expressed by the attendees at a recent workshop in Ermelo? It does seem like there is big opportunity, but that potentially the story, the narrative, is not being communicated effectively to those affected communities.
Spot on, Michael. You know, the initial part of our conversation dealt around engineering challenges, modeling challenges, financial challenges, all the technical aspects. What we understand as the PCC, especially since we had the Just Transition Framework adopted in 2022, by cabinet, is that we have to articulate between empirical evidence, science, academics, engineering, etc., on the one hand, and social partnering on the other hand. Because while they might appear to be two very different spheres of reality, unless we get the articulation right between people on the one hand and technology and processes on the other hand, we will fail to implement. So very interestingly enough, Komati was shut down, its last unit, in October, November 2022. And that then started a period of preparing for what we call a repurposing and repowering of that power station by Eskom. And as we went to the ground to talk about just transition and what it means for communities, the PCC itself realized that there was discontent, that there were weaknesses, gaps, perhaps even dire omissions in the way in which planning led to decisions, led to implementation. And so it was the PCC itself that early on last year started raising the issue. If we were to do this on scale, and if we were to do this on a consistent basis as we came to the end of life of the Eskom fleet of power stations, what are the lessons to be learned from Komati? And I put it to the Secretariat of the PCC that we absolutely of necessity need to claw back on the omissions, on the failures, and on the oversights that accompanied the Komati decision-making. And so the PCC itself went to Komati twice last year, first on a fact-finding mission on an objective basis, and secondly, towards the latter part of last year, to go back to the community to share what our views and findings were. And then we prepared and presented to the president a report called Komati. It's on the basis of that report that we will now proceed as the PCC to also inform the processes through which, and you raised this in an earlier exchange with me, is this just transition concept, you know, just a statement of principle that is sitting somewhere in the ether? No. What we're finding is that Komati is a living, breathing platform from which we need to test the hypothesis that there needs to be all three elements of justice as contained in the just transition if we are to technically, scientifically, and project-wise implement this transition successfully. So in the case of Komati, we are now stepping back a little bit. We are ensuring that we facilitate the setting up of community structures that can make the community an essential part of the process going forward. But importantly, we have engaged with ESCOM, who have now admitted that because of the constrained manner in which they themselves operate as an engineering and operating institution, they should have and did not cast their sight and net wider as it relates to the transition that Komati as a local area needs to undergo. And so those conversations are taking place. The president accepted our report with gratitude. And in Komati, what we will do in the coming year is prove the concept that the just transition is indeed feasible, together with a rollout of not just shutting down coal-fired power stations, but in fact utilizing that as an opportunity to repurpose and repower them, and thereby protect and preserve, although differently skilled, some jobs in that vicinity, but much more importantly, as a partnership between national, provincial, and local government, develop local economic development plans and maximize the input of especially grant and concessional capital that might be available behind the mega projects, which we believe through development finance and private financing, as well as ESCOM's balance sheet, can be afforded on a viable basis.
And on that point, is going to be critical if you're going to be developing a project to have clear definitions in order to access the funding that is available through not only the JET IP, but there are vast sums of capital available globally for projects of this nature. And so the plan speaks of a JET project register and funding platform. So maybe you can just talk me through how that's going to work in order to ensure that you know project developers can at least align with what it is funders are looking for in order to unblock capital and ensure that it flows into the right areas where it's so desperately needed.
Absolutely right. What raised the need for a project register was in fact the differentiated nature of finance being offered by each partner in the International Partners Group. We had early on argued that there needs to be coherence to the funding. Unfortunately, the funds that have been pledged, some of it has flown, some of it still to flow, were premised on there being grant, deeply concessional, and then leveraged either development finance or private sector finance. And what this meant was that, to the point that you're making, different projects have different characteristics and therefore a need for different mixes of capital. The international community have their own development institutions, some of which have had long histories in South Africa. So, for example, the Germans have both KfW as well as GIZ on the development side. The French have the ADB, and the US has their development corporation. And to various degrees, these are governed in their own governance structures, as well as within their own national jurisdictions. And they all have developed their own sense of where grant capital should flow. Should it be technical assistance? Should it be grant tranches leveraging other sectors, including private sector, in financing? And so this mix proved to be very onerous. And the need for this project register arose in the first instance because we wanted to really understand what the quantum and nature of the grant component of this offer was. And we did not want a situation where everybody decided to jump into different parts of South Africa and do their own thing as it relates to what they believed to be just transition projects. And so the project register in the first instance was necessitated by an understanding of the grant component and the deeply concessional components of the monies that each one of the members of the IPG were pledging. Secondly, as the JET implementation plan evolved and now adopted by Cabinet in November last year, it more fully enunciated what individual projects or programs would look like within the three sectors that we've already talked about. And so what is emerging now is a very clear enunciation of critical paths as well as secondary pathways through the project plans or project pathways for each of these three sectors. And we now see a need to ensure that if nothing else, we have a clear enunciation of those projects so that even if government itself is not leading or coordinating those, government in a visible and publicly shared way has a sense of what the progress along various project pathways would look like. Now, without getting into very granular detail, let me say that any register needs to be robust. And for this reason, it is not just a simple listing of projects. What it will do is list projects by way of project pathways. And that then means that each of those projects or combination of projects into programs would need to understand what the sources of capital are, what are the activities within that project, who are the implementing institutions, which, by the way, has not yet been decided. And I personally think that each project or program should have its own unique, properly enunciated implementation partnership model. And then, of course, the issues with respect to Forex. Issues with respect to, is this in local currency or global currency? What is the duration of the project? Dates, start dates, project progress dates, who are the parties to whatever agreements might be in place with respect to specific projects or programs? And this database or this set of fields is now being more clearly enunciated to give us a database that is useful rather than just a shopping list of what each project look like.
And through doing that, identifying those financial needs and challenges, you've then proposed the solution of the just transition financing mechanism, and the institutional framework that you put forward is incubating that JTFM within an existing PFMA entity such as the Development Bank of Southern Africa. Just take me through that JTFM and why you consider that probably the strongest institutional option that we have, and what potential advantages and also potential challenges might come with this approach. Because while we do certainly know the PFMA is worthwhile in terms of preventing corruption and things like that, it has also been critiqued for making decision-making overly onerous and mendacious and bureaucratic and slow. And really, we do need to be moving with some speed, Taps.
Sure. And Michael, this is where perhaps we created a little bit of confusion between us or as a result of having different time perspectives on a just transition financing mechanism. So let me clarify upfront. The JET investment plan and now the implementation plan makes recommendations for the creation of what is called a JET funding platform in the first instance, at least for the next short term up to 27-28, while the PCC, looking forward to what is needed to scale up so that we can accelerate to 2050, is really thinking about what the institutional and financing arrangements should be for the entirety of the just transition. So let me say that the reference to the DBSA is an emerging proposal by the PCC for the medium to long term. But having said that this will be developed around a DBSA set of capabilities, we are still debating whether it is within the DBSA or leveraging the capabilities of the DBSA for a different, slightly arm's length institution that also encompasses, at least in the advisory board, players from the private sector, both sectoral as it relates to industry, as well as financing as it relates to both the banking system, as well as the investment and asset management system. Of necessity, if we are to attract foreign capital, then we're also looking at who would be adequately able to represent foreign capital in a way that gives comfort that both institutional and governance rigor is accompanying this bid. So let me say that the implementation plan for the JET sees at this point in time a slightly more flexible arrangement where they're looking at who are the potential sources, particularly of grant funding. Secondly, where are the beneficiaries for just transition projects, particularly not necessarily big engineering and infrastructure type of projects? And what would then be a softer mechanism of matchmaking so that we get a degree of alignment, coordination, if possible, and coherence in the very limited tranches of grant that are available to maximize the impact by matchmaking carefully with projects that are identified as being just transition. Let me pause here and say, you know, the needs of South Africa, given our degrees of unemployment, given our economic growth rate, given the extent to which the social needs by far outweigh the availability of resources, without wanting to prescribe anything, we felt it was necessary to find a way of getting socioeconomic type of projects categorized by whether they also meet the just energy transition requirements. And I'm not saying give them preferential status, but find a way of incorporating them into the large viable projects in a way that bring institutional rigor and transparency, and in particular, good governance, so that there's no leakage. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. I'm glad you mentioned that, because often in the ESG debate, we talk about E with a capital E, and in South Africa, a lowercase s and a lowercase g, and they all just need to be in caps. They need to be
correct,
dealt with equally, especially given the context that we find ourselves in South Africa as a developing country.
Exactly. And so I think what we're saying is that there's a real opportunity to accelerate and scale up the just transition components related to, for want of a better term, ESG, if they are sitting side by side with the large mega projects that will have built-in viability, either because they are bankable in their own right or because they are so essential that government creates incentive mechanisms to crowd in that financing for the grid, financing for decommissioning, financing for repurposing and repowering, entering into PPAs, whether it's through Eskom or through, at some point, municipalities, because the new Energy Regulations Act makes provision, actually, for municipalities to participate potentially in private sector arrangements that sees municipalities entering into PPAs with independent power producers.
On that point, Dipak, we could carry on for the rest of the morning, but we have to end it there. We've certainly run out of time, but I think a great table setter for the rest of the year, and I look forward to continuing to have this discussion with the PCC. Hopefully we can have some other commissioners on the show taking this conversation forward. There's much to still talk about with the new IRP published, and clearly that has raised certain eyebrows in some sectors as well. And then hopefully we can go a little bit deeper into new energy vehicles and green hydrogen, two very interesting areas of that three-prong approach that is being advocated by the Presidential Climate Commission. To you and also to your family as well, have a fantastic 2024. And thanks so much for joining us on the podcast. Take care.
Thank you very much, Michael, for this opportunity. And I think time flies when you're discussing huge, complex, and very interesting topics. And I look forward to continuing this conversation on the just energy transition and indeed the just transition more broadly through the course of this year. Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Well, that was Dipak Patel. He is Head of Climate Finance and Innovation at the South African Presidential Climate Commission, the PCC, talking and traversing wide territory today, climate finance mapping, financing the just transition, and developing an overarching strategy for how we finance a pathway to a net zero emissions target for South Africa by 2050, and while leaving no worker and no affected stakeholder behind. Indeed, a big goal, but it needs to be tackled because ultimately these things are going to take over and get ahead of us if we don't. So I trust you found it interesting on the Monocle Banking Podcast. Remember to like the podcast and subscribe. We're on all good podcast platforms. We'll be back with you next week where we've got Farzam Azani. He's the founder and CEO of Valar, one of the country's leading crypto exchanges, talking about the recent ETFs that have been vetted by the SEC, the Securities and Exchange Commission in the US, and what that means for the broader adoption of cryptocurrencies. From me, Michael Avery, take care.